Just a quick introduction of who I am, if I can get this to, there we go. So this session this morning is what we call Avoiding the Pilot Trap. And my name is Alan Percy. I'm the Senior Director of Marketing for Audio Codes. And Audio Codes is, I think most of you are probably a little familiar with the company, but we're celebrating our 20th year this year of building the enabling technology to build the next generation voice in networking equipment solutions. We, a little bit of history of the company. We started out originally by the three gentlemen, the three founders. One of them is still our CEO, Shabtai Adlersberg, who's here this week. Initially just designing voice compression algorithms. And one of their voice compression algorithms was eventually adopted as the standard G723.1, which is one of the most common voice compression algorithms that are used in the wireline networks. They came up with these algorithms, and then the customer sort of said, the algorithm's great, but you know, we really would like it if it would be easier to implement. So they eventually embedded that algorithm on a set of DSP chips based on Texas Instruments chips. And then they eventually moved on to delivering those chips as boards or modules. Then the boards and modules slowly went into like PCI or compact PCI form factor, then eventually into packages or appliances, including media gateways. And of course, most folks know us because of our media gateway technology, because that's a very popular technology or a networking element today, helping people make that transition from the TDM to the SIP world. So that's sort of 20 years in a nutshell, but we have many more, many things beyond that. We're going to talk towards the end of the presentation about some of the other resources and skills you brought. I'm joined also today, we've got a couple of co-presenters who I'll introduce in a few minutes here as we get into the session to talk about, again, what we call the pilot trap. So let's get started. So a lot of folks sort of say, you know, when we look at the unified communication challenges, and you look at what has happened in building unified communication solutions, this is generally what a lot of folks see. And if you've been involved in deploying Lync, this should look pretty familiar. You know, over here on the left, this is the mediation server here, and you turn a little crank on a mediation server, and of course it makes the little rubber band snap, which makes the boot kick your edge server. Then the little marble from the edge server falls into the bathtub, which then drops down and kicks the little person into you know, into the Lync server pool, and eventually, you know, so it's very complex. I'm sure you folks know that getting all the pieces together and getting them in the right spot and position is all part of it. And I brought a couple copies of the game here that I don't know how many of you folks are old enough to have actually played the game. Yeah, right. So it's a fun little game, and we'll, by the end of today's session, we'll give those two games away. But what we're discovering in the marketplace is that, you know, getting these pieces together, one of the nice things of having open UC solutions is getting all the parts and components aligned together. And for our integrators and end customers, sometimes this is how it looks. And for us to succeed, it can't look like that. It needs to obviously be much more simplified and much more straightforward for them. So what I came here today is to talk about how to avoid some of the complexities or some of those problems. What we've, from our analysis, then we came up with a concept of the pilot trap. And the best way to sort of describe the pilot trap is explain how you get caught by the pilot trap. You know, pilot obviously is the early deployment or the first sort of evaluation of Microsoft Lync or any of the other UC platforms. And what we see generally is folks don't necessarily charge into their UC or their Lync deployment with necessarily quite the plan that they had anticipated. And sometimes they start out sort of inadvertently, and they start out sometimes without a lot of training. And that's probably the first steps here, is that they'll start out and say, well, let's just dabble with it, right? We're smart guys. We probably, you know, we can figure this out. It's not that complicated. So we're just going to start dabbling with it and start working with some of the software, maybe download it. Came with our CAL license, for example. We'll just we'll start to sort of load it up, start to work with it, and maybe without a lot of training, especially if they're from the IT space, not from the telecom space. There's a lot of telecom technology that maybe the training you haven't been exposed to or haven't had an opportunity to work with yet. So we can start out maybe without all the training. The next step then is we're going to put this on our current network. In most businesses, their existing networks were designed obviously around their email and web browsing, you know, the typical sort of IT applications. There maybe was some thought about putting voice and video on those networks, but in a lot of cases, this might not be this might be the first time that those kinds of tools have been used on the network with any significance. You know, before that, it might have been sort of casual video testing or some evaluation. So we're not quite sure what happens with our network, and a lot of businesses too, from the network standpoint, they're very complex, maybe not necessarily well-documented networks. Maybe they don't exactly know where everything is and where all the pieces and parts are, what revisions some of the switches and routers are. It's not uncommon to find folks say, well, you know, my Wi-Fi infrastructure, too, is a little ad hoc and was not necessarily well-structured. So we're not quite sure what our network situation is. And so that's sort of step two in our heading towards the trap. Step three is the most common way that people start to implement Lync is to first implement IMP, just, you know, instant messaging and presence, implement that and deploy it to a wide audience within the company in our pilot group. And that gives some huge productivity enhancements right away, right? So having the presence and instant messaging is one of the big benefits of the Lync environment. And the side effect of that is that you get users have the client on their desktop, and they become a little bit familiar with the environment, and they get sort of hooked on it. I know when I first was exposed to Lync and an IMP environment, for me, it was such a huge improvement in productivity. It was like, you know, sort of pry it out of my cold, dead hands because you fall in love with it right away. So IMP is the next step. And we're not going to turn on voice quite yet. So now we're going to start to look at voice enabling this. So I'm going to take my little pilot group, and I'm going to use my pilot group as sort of the guinea pigs. And what I'm going to do is, but I know I need some phones and probably some headsets, but I'm not quite sure which ones I'm going to choose for the long haul. So I'm going to go into TechNet, and then there's this huge long list of devices, right? There's all these phones and all these headsets and all these other devices, and they're all Lync compatible, and I don't know which ones to choose. So I'm going to turn to maybe social media. Maybe I'm going to go to LinkedIn and root around in LinkedIn and maybe ask some buddies, you know, what'd you use, and maybe buy a couple of little of everything to sort of give it a test. Well, the side effect is then you end up with a sort of weird combination of bits and pieces, and none of it was homogenized. It wasn't all chosen together as a suite. Instead, it's this sort of basket of parts. Right? I'm going to evaluate these basket of parts. I'm going to give them to my pilot group. So now what happens is we're going to start to turn on the voice features. My pilot group, maybe I'm going to choose the 25 or 50 people in my pilot group, and I'm going to give them this basket of parts and on my unsure network, and I'm going to start turning on the voice features. And they're going to start to experience the voice and video collaboration of Lync, and they love it. It works great. No issues, no voice quality issues, maybe some little compatibility issues we had to work out with these devices, but things started to work. So I'm going to add some more users. So I'm going to go from my 25 first pilot to let's go to 50. All right. So we add the next 25, and things work. They fall in love with it. They stand around the water cooler talking to their other coworkers. This thing is the coolest thing in the world. You wouldn't believe how cool this Lync is. We can do all this conferencing, collaboration. We can screen share. I can video. I can do all this stuff. I got a camera now. It's awesome. So then the 50 turns into 75. Then the 75 turns into 100. And before you know it, all of a sudden, some problems start to creep in. Some voice problems and some voice quality problems start to creep in. And this is what we call hitting the trap. And the trap really is that you've created an environment where the users love the application. They love the productivity enhancements.
Come on in,
Sheila.
All right,
good morning.
Sorry, as long as I interrupted this much, I might as well say hello.
Yeah, that's okay. No, great. Thanks for coming. So what we've done, basically, is we've got them hooked on the productivity enhancements. We didn't necessarily do all that upfront homework that we should have done. So they're hooked on the productivity enhancements, but I can't go forward because I know there's problems because we're having voice quality problems. My executives now are saying, wait a second here. You're having voice quality problems, or you're having performance or feature problems. So I can't go forward because I can't add more people to the solution because we're having these problems. But then again, I can't go backwards either because people are sort of hooked on this functionality. So this is what we call the pilot trap. And we've run into a number of situations where businesses have ended up in the spot where they've inadvertently piloted themselves to a dead end, where going forward is difficult and going backwards is difficult, and they're stuck with a situation. So we're going to talk about how to avoid it, and we're going to talk about some remedies, and we're going to talk about some real-world cases today about how to avoid this. So let's talk about what went wrong first. And I simplified it down to sort of three basic things. Education expertise, I'm going to talk about this in some more detail. Also, too, the network readiness, and we'll talk in detail about how to prepare, do network readiness and how to prepare a network. And lastly, the device selection process and how do you choose the devices for your network. And again, we'll dig into this in a little bit more detail. So three basic building blocks to work on. So let's start out with education. Well, you know, by being here, you're probably taking one of the biggest steps towards the education process, right? You're getting taking the opportunity to sit through some of the readiness classes. You've probably heard about some of the Microsoft training, both end user and also administrator training. That's offered by Microsoft. Obviously, there's tons of online resources on Microsoft's website. But I also want to remind folks, too, that you know the device manufacturers also have training courses and classes. There's some, you know, a number of other resources. In addition to that, there's some third-party resources. And if you folks haven't done so, you know, places like the SIP School and others have really good online training classes, at least so you have the basic understanding of what's going on with some of the protocols and have some of the terminology under your belt. So this is important. That's sort of, I call it table stakes. One of the other important things is securing a trusted advisor. You know, I don't know a partner or an end user who has the expertise to not lean on somebody for this this kind of deployment. So what we highly encourage is that our partners and our end users, you know, figure out who's that trusted advisor. Who's going to be there when you just cannot figure this thing out, or you just can't quite figure out where this is going to go, or what the challenge, you know, the solution to their challenges are? And these are, you know, again, some of the professional services groups within the device manufacturers, definitely the consulting partners. You know, some folks have really done a great job of building practices in that front. Certainly, the systems integrators have, you know, begin to offer just professional services offerings that are there sort of as a backup. And, you know, the voice TSPs, consultants, and there's a whole sort of category of freelancers that have sort of grown out of this industry. And the last, you know, developing that sort of relationship so that you know you've got somebody you can lean on. And we got some feedback on this, too. So Carrie Dick, who's the director of the UC Adoption Practice at Unify Square, gave us a quote here saying, you know, often the most overlooked component of a deployment is end-user training, which leads to poor user experience. So this is a sort of a reinforcement. Don't forget about it. While you might get your training to help develop your network, it's just as equally important to help the end users understand what they're getting involved in so that their user experience matches their expectations, because sometimes that solves a lot of the problems. So that's some good advice. So next, let's talk about the what we call the voice enablement shopping list. You know, there's lots that needs to be a lot of pieces to this puzzle that need to be purchased. So you've gone from an IMMP deployment, we've implemented those servers, and now we're going to start to talk about implementing voice. So what is there? So certainly some media gateways, right, connecting the solution to either an existing PBX or to the public network, to the TDM public network. Maybe some survivable branch appliances, you know, connecting not only to local access for those branch offices, but providing you know, some survivability at your branch offices. Maybe enterprise session border controllers to support SIP trunking. Maybe there's recording logging that needs to be as part of the solution. So we got to choose that component. Maybe the network management software. Certainly your Lync certified IP phones. Choosing someone for your source of professional services, and of course, last but not least, your headsets and all the other accessories that go along with. So there's a lot to choose here. And you have to make, you know, how do we make sure that these pieces all play together? So the process that we recommend is sort of a best practice is to start with identifying the device use cases. And this is something that's actually interesting. Plantronics did a really good job in the previous session talking about the use case scenario. You know, looking at people differently than you did with the old PBXs. You know, with PBXs, it's sort of one size fits all. You know, everybody gets a 2500 set, or they get, you know, whatever their desktop set is. And the way businesses worked is you deployed all the same phone on everybody's desk, and then they just sort of figured it out how to work around it, right? With UC, it's a little different. Now we can look at what's the person's job, and how do I want to provide the connectivity based on their role and the level of mobility or their work environment. So they might be someone who's desk bound, right? It's sort of got a cube inside of a larger office for their work environment. That's a very different situation than a highly mobile traveling executive, or from a service tech, or for a forklift operator. These are all very different use cases that have very different needs. So you need to look at, you know, do they need just a client headset? Is it that executive that's on the go all the time? Do they need a desk phone? If so, you know, what kind of use do they have for that desk phone? Is it something they're going to be on every day? Is it just sort of a backup for their headset? What about those common area phones? We talk about the three L's, you know, the loading room, the lunch room, the lobby, and the lunch room. You know, those are three places where phones are for places, not people. That sort of changes with UC. All right, we had it with the PBX environment, but didn't quite sink in, is that there are places that need phones. Other examples might be, you know, the elevator phone. What about that the phone that's in the pool at the hotel? You know, there's some places you just need these extra phones for places. Certainly the conference rooms, an attendant and their special needs, and this last be, you know, this analog devices, like I mentioned, you know, the elevator and the other places. So, you know, what are the use cases and document them, sort of figure that out, and then choose a supplier for those components. So how do you make this decision? Well, certainly cost is a big piece. Compatibility, certainly if it's compatible with Lync, that's important, but there might be some other sort of compatibility issues you might want to concern yourself with. For example, what kind of compatibility does it have with our network management system or my network monitoring software? You know, besides just being compatible with Lync, you might have to worry about that. Also, too, there's this user experience consistency. This is one of the things that's sort of popped in a couple places. You know, if you buy two or three different phones, if one phone has an orange button and another one has a black button and the third one doesn't have that button at all, and the help desk is trying to walk through, well, what's going on? Well, I hit the orange button. Wait a minute, which phone do you have? You know, the user experience is different based on the brand phone that you buy, even though they're all Lync compatible. So you might want to give that some consideration. Then you get into sort of the inventory, spares, and asset management. This is, you know, becomes an issue. You really can't give everybody the option of any phone off of TechNet. You know, imagine telling your employees, hey, by the way, just go on TechNet and pick a phone out, and we'll just support it. Don't worry about it. And it's every IT person's worst nightmare. Right? So you probably need to narrow it down to a handful so that you can keep some spares in the inventory so that when they do eventually dump their coffee in the phone, that you actually have a replacement at some place in the facility that you can get them moving again. And then it's sort of, you know, the administration of those different devices, and then the dreaded BYOD. So how many of you folks are doing BYOD? Anybody doing BYOD with their phones? I didn't think so. Oh, there's one. All right. I mean, whether, you know, the handset or the hardwired phone, everybody do BYD for, yeah, obviously that's an area we haven't gone, but I don't think it's not that far off, because if you think about work at home workers, it could happen, right? You could say, you know, it's BYOD headset, right? Go online and buy yourself a Plantronics headset. It's yours to keep. It's a personal item. I don't want it back, right? It's got your earwax in it, ooh, so I don't want it back. But that's your headset, so that's BYOD, right? How do I make sure that that device is compatible with our software as we go forward? So sort of interesting thoughts that happen with the UC environment, and you might want to think about those policies. Another quote here from Kevin Peters, the Unified Communications Architect at Unified Square, sort of, you know, great device selection and user fit is a critical success factor. Rip and replace desk phone strategies are often expensive and fail. And what he's basically saying here is if you take the paradigm of the old PBX, which is where everybody gets a gray phone and it's got an orange button on it, across the board, and you rip those all out and stick one device in its place, their thought process is that is not a recipe for success, but instead analyzing what each individual person's tasks or jobs are and then choosing devices for them from a subset of the global universe of available things is the best thing to do. So it's probably good advice. So next to the best practice is the network readiness. And this is this sort of the issue of my network. I started deploying Lync, but I really didn't build my network knowing I was going to have Lync. I built my network based on my data needs, and we're going to start putting voice and video, and especially desktop sharing, on this data network. What do I do? How do I make sure that it's ready? And one of our network architects sort of guy said, you know, give it to me in 7 steps. No, I said, first give it to me in 4 steps, and he gave me 7. But, you know, basically, this is the process that is used for a network assessment. So we're going to start out with, first of all, documenting your network architecture. How many of you know every single element in your network and have already figured out what revision every router and switch is in your network? Yeah, all right. Oh, there's one guy in the back, all right. Yeah, so it's pretty hard for most folks to say exactly what is my network, what does it look like? It's not typically information that's at your fingertips at this point because networks tend to evolve. It's in rare cases where you have a greenfield where the network's from scratch. The second thing is identifying what we call probe points. And the probe points are places in the network where you feel that you can measure the network traffic and you can watch for traffic bottlenecks. So these are long-haul hops over your WAN, maybe certain entry points or exit points in and out of certain premise situations. What you're going to do is you're actually going to install a probe, and this is step three. And the probe is a piece of software that's going to watch the network traffic and be able to then report back as to what the traffic profile is. Not only how much traffic is going through the network, but also is there latency being introduced, or is there jitter in that traffic? Is it dropping packets? Those kinds of things, and report that back. And then what happens with this probing process then is you then initiate some load simulation on the network and you begin to measure it. This is especially important, by the way, with wireless infrastructure. One of the biggest things that businesses discover about UC is that all of a sudden their laptop becomes their phone, and their laptop can get undocked and walk, and they go into conference rooms, and they use their laptop as a phone in the conference room, and they're putting all that load on the network, and it's not just one person, of course, it's a lot of the organization. So you're moving a lot of that traffic that used to be desk-bound, wired, suddenly to your Wi-Fi network. In a lot of cases, it's kind of shaky as to whether or not it can handle it. So we're going to put load simulation, do some analysis, and then typically make some recommendations or, you know, analyze the results and say, all right, here's a bottleneck point, so let's fix that. And that can either be revising software on devices or, in some cases, it can be, you know, augmenting the actual network infrastructure. And, of course, then sort of go through the cycle, retesting, validating, until we get to a point where we feel comfortable that this network now can handle that kind of traffic. So one last comment on that is Bill Skinner, our professional services director at Audio Codes, his comment was, you know, in his experience, the network readiness is by far the most common source of voice quality dissatisfaction. It's not the phones, it's not the gateways, it's not the session border controllers, not the headsets. It's turned out to be the vast majority of the time it's a router that's out of rev, it didn't have QoS turned on, it's a choke point in the network, it's a port on a switch that's configured for half duplex. Little silly things like that. And when we get to our case study, you'll hear about some of the issues that have popped up. So there's lots of decisions. We've talked about all these challenges. There's all these things that come to you as either partners or end users that you have to deal with. You know, all these different vendors, all these different devices that we talked about, that long list. You know, what about getting support between the different vendors? Your operational challenges and some of the complex installations. And what we've done is we've taken a unique approach here at Audio Codes to sort of get rid of all that mess, and we've created a new initiative that you've heard about this week called Audio Codes One Voice for Lync. And what this is a unified branding and unified product offering suite that now combines both the devices of the network elements that you would need to implement Microsoft Lync, but in addition to that, also the services offering to our partners and the support offering for both our partner and end customers to simplify this process. And the idea is to dramatically simplify this whole process, you know, of turning the little crank to get the edge server, to make the little shoe, to kick the little marble down the thing, to simplify that and package it in such a way that you don't have to make these decisions. So what all is involved in it? Well, we know that there's many different elements around the outside edge here that are necessary to implement Lync. You know, we've talked about some of them before, but these are some of the areas that you typically are worried about. You know, am I going to use SIP trunking? How am I going to integrate into TDM trunking? How am I going to monitor my voice quality? What am I going to do about my survivable branch appliances? What about phones, call recording, voice applications, DECT support? Local PBX integration, and again, you know, integrating in with IP PBXs. You know, we've taken all these sort of attributes and combined them together and connected them together with our One Voice strategy. And this is a combination of our media gateways, our enterprise session border controllers, our survivable branch appliance devices, our IP phones, and a number of software elements that are necessary to manage and support those into a complete voice solution offering for Lync.
Alan,
yeah.
Really,
pretty much across the gamut. We've gotten engaged in very small ones to, you know, the largest global distributed organizations.
Where's your sweet spot right now?
So probably it's, you know, it's mid to upper, mid market up to the enterprise. Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah. Well, it's pretty much trends along with Lync. You know, I know there are small Lync. I know there are small Lync implementations, but right. And of course, you know, the challenges tend to come at the mid and upper end of the market, right? Okay. So we've put together, like as I said, you know, a collection of the network elements. We've put together a real strong professional services offering to support our partners in their professional services, and of course, a strong support offering as part of the solution. So what I thought I'd do is I just start out with a couple of quotes here that we've, when we announced this a few weeks ago, that I thought would be interesting. Marty Parker, one of the co-founders of UC Strategies, when he took a look at our program, said, you know, that we've correctly identified and addressed the challenge faced by many customers as they migrate to Lync. You know, he hears it often, and he supported us on that. Diane Myers, the principal analyst at Infonetics, you know, recognized that Microsoft's continuing to have strong gains, attaining the number one position, and that AudioCodes One Voice for Lync is a broad complement of solutions for this growing base of these UC deployments. And last but not least is Giovanni Mezic, you know, the general manager at Microsoft, who did the opening keynote. He'll give us a comment here, seeing that AudioCodes One Voice for Lync, the Microsoft program, is an opportunity to accelerate deployment of voice-enabled Microsoft Lync. So real great positive reinforcement for what they're saying. So what are some of the benefits to the end customers? Well, it starts with simplification, right? So one of the key things is reducing the number of vendors. So instead of going out and saying, well, I'm going to choose three different phone vendors, and I'm going to choose two or three different, I'm going to choose a gateway from this vendor, and I'm going to choose a session border controller from this other vendor, and have to learn and get educated on all those devices and have to worry about maintaining certification from those different vendors. What I'm going to do is simplify all that by, you know, reducing the number of vendors you need to deal with. There's less contracts, that, therefore, I can leverage some of the incentive programs that they've got much easier, reduce the amount of time it takes to get trained, reduce some of the pricing, and of course, be able to go to one point for support, so there isn't sort of that finger pointing that would happen between vendors of, well, you know, I know that they say there should be a plus in front of the phone number, but we say there isn't. So, you know, that sort of stuff that happens back and forth between vendors. So we think this is a real important part to a successful migration. So what I'm going to do is ask Jeff to come on up here. So Jeff, introduce you here real quick. Jeff's one of our end customers. Jeff works, he's the network manager for the American Axle in manufacturing. And so maybe we'd start out, Jeff, with just a quick introduction of, you know, who's American Axle, and we'll go from there.
Sure, perfect. Thanks for having me up, Alan. It kind of follows on your earlier question, what's the sweet spot? We are the largest small enterprise, I like to say, in the business. We're a global company. We have to follow our customers, General Motors, Ford, Daimler, and the other automotives and large vehicle manufacturers around the globe. 32 locations, over 10,000 employees. When you take out the factory workers, we're about 3,500 knowledge workers that sit at a desk and have some type of computing requirements.
Right.
And we're in just about every theater you can think of, from Asia working backwards through Europe, Latin America, and the U.S.
And when we talked yesterday, we chatted a little bit about sort of where you are in the Lync process. But talk a little bit about what your business was like before you implemented Lync. What was the environment before you implemented Lync?
So prior to Lync, we fit a lot of what you said earlier. It was almost like you took my notes and said, "I'm going to make sure I rib Jeff really good when he gets up here and make him uncomfortable," because I really was uncomfortable as he was getting the trap up here ready to fall on top of me. We were very much a Nortel shop. We still are a Nortel shop, both data as well as PBX. We followed the CS100 path with our PBX platform. We linked CS1000.
I'm sorry, you said 100. Okay.
I was just was just talking.
100 or CS
1000. It's the caffeine.
Yeah.
If I talk too fast, it's the caffeine talking.
Yeah.
We link them all together, build a separate VLAN, have successfully run that environment. We subscribe to the Microsoft Nortel strategy that created what was known as Nortel Converged Office that allowed Nortel phones to ring when your OCS, enterprise voice, if you will, and OCS, they went together. And then I think we all know the path that Nortel went down, which kind of came to a swift conclusion for us in terms of that deployment. I would best categorize it as the science project. You didn't call it that, but I like that phrase.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it was a science project within IT, and it never got rolled out to the enterprise. We have a lot of OCS out there. We have a lot of people using 2007 R1, which was the only approved release from Nortel with Converged Office, but they're just doing instant messaging and presence. We're up to about 1,200 users of that, but only a handful, less than 120, had the enterprise voice capability with OCS. So that's our legacy. That's
right.
That's where we were. So prior to 2011.
Yeah, exactly. So then now, obviously, now you've started to introduce Lync into the organization, and where are you in this whole process now?
So in 2011, leadership came to me and said, what's our strategy going to be? Our PBX vendor's gone broke. What are we going to do? Unified communication seems to be the direction. So after a good amount of investigation, we landed on Lync. We're a significant Microsoft shop, and it seemed a natural progression from the Nortel-Microsoft partnership over to just a straight Microsoft environment. So we went down the path that you put up here as you ribbed me. We started out with a very small group of 12 Petri dish, not a proof of concept, but I called it our Petri dish. And we deployed Lync with enterprise voice and tested it with those 12 users and said, hip, hip, hooray, it's going well.
Yeah. Then let me guess, you added more.
And then we said, well, let's take the science project people that have Nortel Converged Office and let's put them onto that. And so we added about 75 people to that. So now we were pushing about 80 users. And that went well.
And that went well, yes.
And then people started clamoring for it. Word got out. And so we're now pushing about 200 users in our enterprise and have laid out the plan following many of the steps that Alan laid out, but not necessarily all of them. So I'm still worried about the trap coming down on me. But we are about to deploy gateways to each of our locations around the globe so that we can have local dial. Since we're in so many different countries, we didn't want to pool it back to our pool sites. And once we have the infrastructure out there is when we're going to begin deploying Lync with enterprise voice to the masses, which I anticipate to be by the end of this year. So right now, to just set the stage, we're at the point where we're about to place the order for all of the infrastructure. We'll spend 6 months deploying that infrastructure globally so that at the end of the year in the fourth quarter, we can take all of the users, put Lync on their desktop, and voice enable them. So that starting in 2014, we will be a Lync enterprise voice shop. The other thing that's worthy of noting is we are not going to do a rip and replace. Enterprise voice is something that'll be offered with simultaneous ring so they can keep the phone on their desk. They can continue using the Nortel PBX, but we're going to gradually pull it away from them over the next 18 to 30 months so that we can migrate away from those PBXs. Take our maintenance contracts and say, instead of spending money here, if you feel you need a phone, we can add a phone, and instead of spending money on a maintenance contract on the PBX, we can buy an awful lot of phones with that and get you out of that legacy phone system over the next 30 months. So it's about a 30-month road from probably January of 2014 to get completely off of PBXs. So that's the vision.
Yep. Yeah. And we talked yesterday about there were two surprises that happened in your pilot you wanted to share. So let's start out with the network surprise.
Sure. Well, the network surprise, we have a partner in Voice Data Systems out of Grand Rapids, Michigan, that is our partner. And they came to us with, they're really smart guys. And we got into a bit of a smart guy versus smart guy wrestling match. And we said, you know, we've got really smart guys too, and we think we know pretty much all the revisions on our switches, and we have a single subnet for our voice and all the rest of this. And they said, if you want us to be involved in this, if you want it to be successful, you need to do a network assessment. I fought it tooth and nail. And lo and behold, of course, the duplex mismatches, the one switch in the network that was botching up everything else that wasn't adhering to all the standards that we thought we had implemented everywhere. And so we uncovered some things that certainly demonstrated to us the value in that network assessment. You can think you've got a really tight shop, which I thought I had a really tight shop, great documentation, guys are following process, but I mean, there's dirt under that rug. There's dirt to be swept under that rug.
That's the first of the 12 steps, don't worry. It's no
idea. Right. So, hi, my name's Jeff, and yes, I have a network problem.
Yeah, exactly.
The other surprise for us, as we got going, and we were using Lync more and more, I started having my weekly global conference calls with my entire team, which is a global team. And I kept running into, you know, the dreaded red bars in Lync and wondering, where in the world is this coming from? And, I mean, Wireshark traces and following packets from here to China and back produced no results. And ultimately what it ended up being, if you've not encountered this yet, is some of the USB incompatibilities, 2.0 versus 3.0. Jeff got a new laptop, and when I started plugging into 3.0 ports on USB, things started behaving differently. And so something that's not much talked about because it should be universal, as in universal serial bus, it's not quite as universal as you might think. Plugging into a docking station, users that have a laptop that plug into a docking station, well, what's in that docking station? It's a USB hub. And then you plug that USB hub, how many of you have large monitors with little USB hubs into them that you can plug devices into? So you go from computer to hub to headset to my Lync experience, and now that Lync experience may not be that great. And we kept finding this over and over and over again. Out of our 200 users, I bet we had maybe a dozen tickets that we tracked down root cause was USB issues. And so as soon as we took USB headsets and plugged them directly into a computer, poof, problems went away. So then we just encouraged the user, you need to figure out, you know, does your docking station, because we have multiple versions of docking stations out there with our Dell laptops, does your docking station work great? And we're working with the desktop guys to try and be able to document which ones work and which ones don't, but generically, we just tell them, plug your USB headset into the computer's USB port, and you'll have a much better Lync experience. Much like we tell them, do not use your microphone and speaker when you're on a conference call because it causes feedback and all kinds of bad things. I mean, that's a standard best practice.
So user training, right?
Yeah. So it's user training. Very, very good. Yeah.
Good.
So that's kind of where we were, and where we are now, and we're about to roll big. And I got to tell you, I need to get back to Detroit and work on some things after you scared the shit out of me.
So, questions for Jeff?
Yes.
Yes.
Jeff, when you say you're going to roll globally from the 200 pilot to the full organization, how many people are talking about?
About 3,500 knowledge workers. So I've got another 3,300 to go. And then you could add on top of that probably another 20% when you start thinking about the triple L's, the lobby phones, the lunchroom phones, and the
loading dock.
Loading dock. And we have lots of loading docks at American Axle, so I have to worry about those things. Lots of legacy fax machines we have to worry about. Yes?
All right, so first question gets the first of the games here, so I'll give David a mousetrap.
Yes? Indian telecom rules, for example?
That's one. E911 and so on. What do you guys have done?
So what we've found thus far in the countries that we're in, E911 really only bites us in some of the states within the U.S. E911. Yeah. So 911 is everywhere, but E911, the requirements of E911 is really just peppering of states here in the U.S. Not all states have a requirement, a hard requirement for E911.
It's even right down to the county.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, in some places.
Telco
compliance is a challenge, especially in India.
What do you guys have done with China?
Well, we're not having any issues in China. We're just following our PBX deployment that we have in China. In India, we just have to be very careful about You know, here in the U.S., the old intralata versus interlata calling and all the rest of that, that we don't cross those lines. So we have to be very specific in our dial plan programming as to what we can and what we can't do.
Good. Well, we're going to hold it at two questions, and then we'll get to more of them after we get done. So let's give Jeff a big round. See, I was just looking at our time here. I want to make sure we have time to cover the rest of the material here. So the next step is sort of talking about, with this program we put together, what are some of the benefits for the Audio Codes partners? Well, the first thing, of course, is that we've created a relationship where we're a trusted supplier, not only of just the technology, but also of the expertise. And for our partners, this is a huge benefit for them to be able to then turn to somebody and be able to get the kind of support. And then also, too, to help some of our partners with some of their marketing projects. To be able to, as a manufacturer, we have funding available to help them raise visibility to not only their capabilities, but also to raise visibility to the solution like Lync in the marketplace. And to talk about that, I've asked Ben Tosato, principal with Conquest, to talk a little bit about some of his customer projects. Ben, why don't we start out with a quick introduction of you and also, too, of Conquest.
Okay, thanks, Alan. So I'm Benjamin Tosato. My company's Conquest Technology Services. We're a 10-year-old business based out of South Florida, and we work on unified communications projects around Microsoft technologies. We are their kind of go-to partner for this in the eastern United States. So for some of their largest customers, when they get engaged and the customer says, listen, we're interested in looking at a unified communication strategy, and that's anything from understanding the value of unified communications to planning out an architecture, doing network assessments, doing deployments, end-user training strategies, ongoing support. We get engaged to do that stuff.
So now Conquest is a partner, right? The difference between what Jeff was presenting was an end-user experience. Now this is a partner experience. And we were chatting about maybe some things that you've learned from supporting your end customers, maybe a couple of key things that sort of help them get through their pilot. So maybe we could chat about a customer or two and some of their challenges and how you worked them past that.
Yeah, sure.
Can we clarify who's partner? Microsoft partner, your partner,
both partners?
Both.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
So we resell Audio Codes equipment as well as a variety of other unified communications vendors. We only work with Microsoft as the core solution, so there's no Cisco or Avaya within our practice. Companies like the one you were just hearing about up here would be like customers of ours.
Yeah. So let's talk about some of the best practices that you've learned in the School of Hard Knocks and being a partner.
So. Yeah. So you did a really good job of articulating a lot of them, I think. Pilots, in our experience, are a necessary part of these deployments, especially when you're ripping out, some entrenched, tried and true communications technology, or if that's the goal, right, over the long term. And pilots done well can really build momentum behind a project, I think, right? But you have to treat pilots like you would treat the full deployment from a planning and execution perspective. Like Alan was saying, if you try to do the whole, sandbox thing, let's make it an IT pep project, let's throw some devices out there, let people kick it around, you're not setting yourself up for success. So to give you guys a couple of examples, we run an actually hosted pilot program for Microsoft, okay? So it's called Experience Voice Now. So the way the program works is we have a hosted version of Lync Voice running in one of our data centers, right? So we go ahead and provision, 10 lines of that. Microsoft, we set it up for the customer. Microsoft ships, 10 devices out to the customer. We do a little bit of network analysis with the customer. Nothing like a full, on-prem deployment or pilot, but a little bit of analysis just to make sure they're going to be able to get up to the cloud solution and successfully make calls and things like that. We do a little bit of discussion around which devices are best fits for end users, right? So we were actually working with a hospital in Kentucky, and we worked with the IT department, talked through the different device scenarios, and they basically said, okay, I think these devices are fits for these folks, these devices are fits for those folks. We didn't involve the end users that were actually going to be participating in the pilot in any of this, right? So we actually had some end users get these devices and have a less than optimal experience. We had some people, for instance, that said, the quote was, I don't want anything on my head. Right? Okay. I don't want anything on my head. Okay. So that would have been really easy to identify had we just gone and talked to those people, right? So I think when you're involving end users in a pilot, you're asking for a commitment, right? That's one of the big things. They're going to have to be dedicating time to this, right? Time that's going to be probably on top of their existing workload. So it's important to really engage them and make sure that, you're providing the best quality experience that fits for them.
Right. So maybe one of the surprises popped up that you maybe didn't expect with in some of your deployments, network issues or sort of things that have sort of popped up that you it was an aha moment.
Yeah, so I think the devices, that's definitely, as we've kind of learned and done deployments with customers, that's something that we've run into a couple of times and kind of evolved. The network aspect of it is really important also. We got into this with Microsoft, the first rev with OCS 2007, right? And we were doing these things without network assessments at that point, right? Mm-hmm. And then we ran into a couple of roadblocks with customers where we had network-oriented issues. So now we've got a whole program built around it. We've got a monitoring tool that we install, very much like you're saying, to make sure that we kind of mitigate all of those types of issues.
Yeah, good. So any questions for Ben?
Just curious about the pilot phase and some of the things that you establish as far as timelines as an integrator, when it stops.
Right.
When it actually becomes production, how do you
set
those?
So there's some interesting things, right? So I think you can take pilots, and this is from an integrator's perspective, right?
You don't have to answer it.
So... So from an integrator's perspective, I think you can lump pilots into kind of two buckets, okay? Bucket one is you've already got customer commitment and customer understanding around the business value of the solution, and the pilot is just part of an overall implementation process. That's where you want to be. That's as an integrator where I want to be, right? I want to be doing a pilot that's part of an overall plan, right, to get this thing rolled out and executed successfully. Where we end up sometimes, right, is piloting to try to win that commitment, right? So in those types of situations, and we still do it, right? We still do it. We have to do it sometimes. And sometimes we're even in a bake-off, right? So we're working on a county government deal in South Florida right now where we're going to have to pilot, right, in addition to Cisco and Avaya. And, based on the success of these different pilots, the customer's going to make a move-forward decision with something, right? So when we're in those situations, I think it's even more important to make sure you have key success criteria established before you start, right? That's one big thing. You don't want to start one of these things without understanding, okay, these are the things that we're going to be evaluating, right? These are the marks we need to hit, and then moving forward like that. And then we always set both a timeline for start and finish, and we set regular touch points within that period to speak with our stakeholders within the customer and speak with the end users that are in the pilot.
Depending on what the value prop is. So do you find that your key success criteria changes by a customer, or do you try to keep it within?
So there's a little bit of variation. There are some underlying ones that you always get, right, that are kind of key concerns that folks have when they're moving to this type of technology. Voice quality, right? I mean, what customer does something like this and doesn't get concerned, right, about, wow, is the phone quality going to suffer, and is that going to, give me some lumps? Service availability, right? Is the stuff going to stay working all the time? And that's really important too. So you're looking at a pilot infrastructure. A lot of times customers don't want to invest in high availability at this point, right? If it's not, part of an overall deployment plan. So you have to think about things like that and make sure you're not putting yourself in a situation where you're gonna take a beating there.
Yep. Good. All right, so let's give Ben a big round of applause for coming up and sharing his story. And both Ben and Jeff will be here for a few minutes afterwards, so if you've got other questions, we can squeeze them in here. So just wanted to wrap up with a couple of next steps. Well, certainly, we've spent a little bit of time here. We learned about pilots. We learned about how to get caught in the trap, and hopefully I've shared with you some little information on how to avoid the trap. At least two people now have their own traps, so they can take that home with them. Obviously, we'd love to have you. I think most of you have already had a chance to stop by our booth. A few of you that haven't, we're booth number 5, which is if you go into the crown room, is over on the left-hand corner. We'd love to stop with you and chat with you some more. We've got a real full comprehensive description of our Microsoft offerings at audiocodes.com/Microsoft. It's all new content. If you haven't been there in the last month, you'll notice it's totally new, totally fresh. We've cleaned it all up and organized it in a new way, so recommend spending some time there. Next is, getting a chance to experience this. Our partner community, like you heard from Ben, they're very, very experienced folks. And they have learned from the school of hard knocks in some cases. In other cases, they've gone to the school of smart knocks. But the end result is there's a tremendous amount of experience in those trusted advisors, I think would help you folks that are end users. And also, too, you know, we've positioned ourselves at AudioCodes to be not only the Lync voice experts, but you know, we really, truly are the voice experts with that 20 years of experience in communications. And last, we would love to stay connected with you with, you know, either whatever the platform of your choice is, whether it's LinkedIn or Twitter, you know, connect with us. We'd love to have you as part of the community in our social media campaign so we can hear from you and we learn as much from you, hopefully, as you learn from us. So with that, appreciate you spending some time with me, and we'll stick around here for a couple minutes. So thanks again.